In the last 3 years, blockchain technology has attracted entrepreneurs, engineers, venture capitalists, and bankers pouring their time, energy, and money into cryptocurrency-related business. There are endless possibilities for blockchain, from securities and commodities trading, to supply chain, to IP rights, to identity management and security, to real estate, to government services, just to name a few. Many industries will be disrupted by blockchain. Our future will definitely include it. Attorneys from Macro International's Blockchain Cryptocurrency Practice Group, held from jurisdictions like Singapore, Serbia, Italy, Hong Kong, Colombia, Romania, United States, and the United Kingdom, etc. They navigate clients who are key players in the blockchain ecosystem through the complex and uncertain business and regulatory landscape surrounding cryptocurrencies and other crypto assets across the world. Clients will benefit from a multi-jurisdiction network of expertise from lawyers with regulatory, corporate, real estate, tax, technology, data protection and privacy, banking, merger and acquisition, and securities laws experiences, as well as being familiar with cutting-edge blockchain technology. I'm Darlene Chen, a corporate attorney from Macro International's member firm, Hoke Benton Jones Appel, located in Silicon Valley, California. It's my honor to serve as a practice group leader and have the opportunity to build up our practice group with our members and the network with the rest of the Macro International community. Today, we're launching our practice group's first official program. We're going to interview our distinguished group member, Andy Updegrove. Andy is the founding partner of Gessmer and Updegrove LLP in Boston. He's been a pioneer in providing business-minded legal counsel and strategic advice to high-tech companies in the past 40 years. Andy is recognized internationally as a leading expert on topics of standards setting, intellectual property policy, consortia governance, and open source development. Outside the office, he's taken to writing fiction, including 5 cybersecurity thrillers, chronicling fictional events that have had a disturbing habit of later actual happening. His latest titled The Blockchain Revolution. The journalist of the day to conduct the interview is Justin Swanson. Justin is an attorney from our member firm, Bosey, McNeil and Evans LLP in Indianapolis. Justin focuses his practice on administrative and economic development needs of the municipalities. We hope through today's program, it will help you to get a glimpse of the history of blockchain technology, the rise of Bitcoin, challenges in the future of digital asset blockchain, and now how it will affect us lawyers if we practice in these areas. Without further ado, Andy and Justin, now it's your show.
Thank you, Darlene, for the introduction. And Andy, thank you so much for your time today and your willingness to share some of the knowledge you've developed over your pretty prestigious career here, both on the legal side and also, as Darlene mentioned, being an author. It's been fun reading some of your work so far. So thanks again for being here. Maybe just kind of jump right into it, Andy. Let's try to demystify this word that gets thrown around quite a bit, blockchain. Can you help us understand what exactly blockchain technology is and maybe possibly some of the benefits that people could leverage from it?
Sure. At its heart, a blockchain is simply a ledger that can exist in duplicate form in an unlimited number of locations. And what makes the blockchain particularly useful and different from that simple concept is that the particular blockchain technology that's grown up is also immutable, meaning that once something is in the blockchain, it can't be changed, and it is supposedly secure. Now, it's hard to believe that anything is totally secure, and I don't believe that the blockchain is totally secure, but let's just say that it's an architecture that by its nature has the capability of being extremely secure. It's also worth noting what it isn't. A lot of people think of the blockchain and Bitcoin or cybersecurities as being the same thing. And while it's accurate to say that probably every cybersecurity that people would have in mind is based upon a blockchain technology. It's simply a use case for blockchain technology. The two aren't the same thing automatically.
That's a great point. And I want to maybe highlight that distinction here in a minute. I do want to hit on one point on this, on blockchain that you brought up, this idea of being immutable. So when the internet first came around, I think people much smarter than myself realized that we're going to have this huge influx of information, of images, of data floating around there. And how can we set up a way to allow not only businesses, but people and really the entire world rely on that data or the images they're seeing as authentic. So in 1991, there was an academic paper released describing the blockchain that kind of solved that very problem in terms of, can we rely on this data that we're getting? And you mentioned too, there is this distinction between Bitcoin and blockchain, and they're not necessarily the same. Can you give us some insight on the differences between Bitcoin and blockchain, kind of dive down into that a little more?
Sure. One element might be worth mentioning is historical. So you have on the one hand, sort of classic academic and industry-based computer development and computer science. And then you have concurrently a, you might almost think, populist aspect of it, which many people are very concerned with privacy. People are very concerned with maybe setting up their own ways of doing things that are independent of the establishment. So there's this long history of activity. One instantiation is Tor, which is basically used for what's usually referred to as the dark internet. It's a way that you can have access to the internet in a highly anonymous form. So there's this whole undercurrent of this culture that gave rise in many ways to the blockchain we have. So even though the blockchain was a concept in one way, it matured largely through this sort of countercultural element that was very concerned with privacy and also took it as a challenge about how could we have financial transactions and how could we transfer money in a way that was totally independent of the establishment and totally invisible to the establishment. So between 1991 and 2008, you have this ongoing conversation on anonymous message boards on the internet that eventually in 2008 gives rise to a proposal by someone known as Satoshi Nakamoto, who remains anonymous, unknown, and as of about 7 years ago, departed individual who proposed this particular method of transaction on the internet, which he called Bitcoin. And it was followed about a year later after he first proposed this with something referred to as the white paper, which is this short document. It's about 13 or 14 pages long, and it lays out Satoshi Nakamoto's vision for a blockchain-based financial system that would have no trusted center point. So one of the concepts that they wanted to get away from is, how do we get away with someone who's the arbiter of trust? You know, you think with a traditional finance, you have a bank, and the bank is supposed to be a trusted entity, but the bank also has total control over all the records. So one goal was, how do we have this network where no one is in charge with it, where no one is the verifier, the single source of trust for the environment, but at the same point, how do we have it be trustable without a center point of trust? And Nakamoto's vision was to have not only the currency of Bitcoin, but a concept of endless nodes where individuals could, quote unquote, mine Bitcoin, and the mining and the creation of those Bitcoins and the transactions could be verified throughout the entire network. So that's your sort of classic cybersecurity blockchain-based use case. And there are now thousands of different coin systems, some dormant, some abandoned, some used, some not. And then you have a parallel use of blockchain technology, which has nothing to do with coins whatsoever. And that is focused on the distributed ledger concept. So it may be used for finance, and a lot of activity, which we can talk about further, has to do with that as being a trusted sort of establishment means of transaction, but you could also use it for just about anything else. And one of the things that I think is a very easy to understand concept would be, you know, the concept of blood diamonds, you know, where people are concerned about the highly exploited nature in which diamonds can come into being. Another might be sustainably sourcing of timber or coffee or anything else. And in this case, you have a long supply chain, which might have, you know, very small users involved in it. And you have the problem of tracking something throughout that supply chain. And this can be a very good use of blockchain, that anyone can have a node of the block or a copy of the ledger where they can log in the course of that diamond or the course of that teak log or the course of that pound of coffee. And it can be a highly trusted, unchangeable medium. There's also sort of a medium range, which is using a blockchain and a coin for a very traditional type of financial transaction. So one of my clients, for example, Hyperledger, is a project under the Linux Foundation, also a client, one of the fastest growing projects they've ever had. And the concept behind that project is to have a highly robust blockchain that can be used by banks and credit card companies and others to have a very robust means of executing trades on a blockchain. Two other things that are notable about this is it's much faster. Blockchain transactions can be transacted almost instantaneously, and they can be cheap. So if you look at, say, someone in the US from Guatemala who wants to send $100 home to their family, they might pay 10 or 15 bucks out of that $100 to do a simple wire transfer. Whereas on a blockchain-based system, it could be for, you know, thousandths of a cent. Or it's another way that someone with no bank account at all can have access to an international financial system. So many different use cases and many more that we could talk about.
So that maybe one distinction for our listeners here then versus, you know, just a traditional blockchain technology versus Bitcoin. Bitcoin's this open source kind of decentralized network where anyone can participate in it. But if I'm someone like Amazon or IBM, or it sounds like Linux, I want to create my own network, but you have to have permission to interact with that network. And that helps. I think companies that are dealing with tons and tons of data, again, make sure that they can rely on the data they're being fed rather than having to hire a third party to make sure and audit that information that's coming on. Is that a good way to describe that?
Yeah, and a way to for people to remember easily is the concept between a public blockchain and a private blockchain. So a private blockchain is just exactly what you mentioned, with permissioned access. And a public blockchain would be something like Bitcoin, where anyone, you know, can become a miner if they, you know, buy a fast enough computer and have access to it immediately without getting permission from anyone.
So why don't we dive into kind of, you mentioned one or two of your clients. We'd love to hear kind of do you see common traits or common obstacles they face when trying to launch new products or bring new products to market?
Sure. Well, one sort of cynical comment I would make would be reality. There was a, you know, just incredible amount of enthusiasm behind the concept of blockchain and the concept of coins in particular. And frequently I'd have a client come to me and say, we have this great business idea and we're going to base it on blockchain. And my first reaction, you know, particularly a few years ago when we were in sort of the, you know, the back end of the enthusiasm where lots of coins were being stolen and lots of, you know, concepts were proven to be not very good, was, just because you can do it on a blockchain doesn't necessarily mean you should do it on a blockchain. And that has two aspects. One is the blockchain approach may not actually be superior. And second of all, particularly if you're going out for investment, blockchain has had sort of a rise and a fall and a rise. So some things can be, you know, viewed as being very appealing to investors at some times, and a year later, they may be something that they want to stay away from. So it's a very usable technology, but it's not always the right technology, you know, for a number of reasons.
So maybe the first step is cutting through the hype and really understanding, is this technology appropriate for a solution, right?
Right. I mean, my favorite example is I ran across one blockchain, which was creating coins for you to use to pay for dental visits. And, you know, the immediate reaction is, you could, but why in the world would you? I think that that one died a pretty quick death.
Yeah, and you'd mentioned, right, this rise and fall of popularity of, you know, some of the buzzwords, Bitcoin or blockchain. I remember a couple of years ago, there was an iced tea company that changed, that added the word blockchain to their ticker symbol on Wall Street. And I think they got their hand slapped for that. Their stock shot up exponentially after that announcement. So
even Kodak, you know, which is, you know, a fallen, you know, giant of, they decided to take a stab at being a blockchain company in their latest struggle for existence. We saw the same thing, you know, 25 years ago when everyone was adding .com to the end of their name, even though they weren't quite sure what relevance it had to their business.
That's a great great analogy. So is there a common you know, are U.S. laws or are they set up in a way that'll attract these types of businesses exploring this new technology, or I mean, kind of what are you seeing on that front?
Well, I think what we've seen with blockchain, to me, since I've been around for a while, you know, was pretty puzzling. In that I've been, you know, practicing securities law, you know, for 40 years, and the way that the securities regulators in the U.S. in particular reacted was with really startling tolerance in the beginning, and very much of a wait and see, and even an encouraging, you know, attitude, which to me was quite interesting. We're now talking primarily about the Obama presidency, so you had these coins come along. And the regulators seem quite willing to say, this is interesting, this is innovative, let's see where it goes. They probably did that for a bit too long. And now we sort of need to introduce another concept that has to do with coins in particular, is the difference between a stable coin and a floating coin. A stable coin is something that you basically peg to a currency or to a basket of currencies. So for example, if you were a bank and you wanted to have a blockchain-based technology, you based it on the dollar. And even though you might have electronic coins, you would stipulate that that coin will always be worth a dollar. Or if you wanted to be more open about it from a global perspective, you might say that we'll peg it to the floating value of the 10 biggest currencies, you know, in the world, and that'll be the value. Bitcoin and Ethereum and most of the other coins are very different in that they are not pegged to a specific currency. So that in the beginning, when Bitcoin came out, conceptually, it was a way to be a substitute for a dollar or a euro. But what happened was, is it became a commodity independent of a currency. And what happened was people started speculating in Bitcoin, and then the value could vary tremendously. And if you look back since Bitcoin has come out, you know, it's has been as high as $20,000 and it's fallen at times, you know, by as much as 70%. So from that perspective, it principally becomes something more like gold, which even though gold has an intrinsic value, its trading value, you know, fluctuates entirely as an investment commodity that has little or nothing to do with its value for industrial uses or jewelry uses. Bitcoin's the same way. It can go all over the map. So from that standpoint, it ends up being not very good at all to be what it was originally intended to be, which was a medium for electronic transactions. And unless you're a day trader, you know, having Bitcoin isn't very good for going and buying something at Amazon, because, you know, one day you might be able to get, you know, five of something, and the next day you might get one of something. So it's sort of departed in that sense from its original purpose. So another problem with Bitcoin, by the way, is it's very slow technology. So even though when it originally came out, it was very cool, it also had problems in that, without getting down in the weeds, is that you couldn't really sustain a global financial system on just the original Bitcoin technology. So later technologies like Ethereum and ones that have come after have tried to deal with this about how do we accelerate this technology to be more useful even for its original purpose.
So, Andy, you'd mentioned earlier that U.S. regulators kind of took either a blind eye or almost encouragement to find out kind of where this new asset class is headed. Where are the regulators now, and has that attitude shifted at all?
Right. Well, a couple of things happened along the way. One was that it turned out that Bitcoin schemes or ecosystems turned out to be not very secure, because it's one thing to say that you've got a highly secure ledger, but when you actually want to transact, you need things besides a ledger, such as an exchange to exchange Bitcoins and a wallet to hold Bitcoins. And while the blockchain was secure, the early technology that grew up around it tended to be, in many cases, very insecure. At one time, a few years ago, 40% of all the cybersecurity coins that had ever been minted had been stolen. When Ethereum came along, a group of enthusiasts created a VC fund around it called DAO, and very quickly, 60 out of the $150 million was stolen. Another figure that I looked up, in 2019, as of the first 6 months in 2019, 20% of all the Bitcoin ever issued were lost. Not because they've been stolen, but because people had forgotten the passwords to their wallets. So you had, on the one hand, the realization that this technology was moving quicker than maybe was consistent with good security. And that was partially because a lot of it was being driven by enthusiasts rather than, you know, hard-hearted capitalists. Not that hard-hearted capitalists are very good about security either, but they're probably a bit better than people in some cases that dove in early with Bitcoin. The second thing, obviously, was that there were huge opportunities for scams. You know, anyone could throw up a coin system. There was huge amounts of enthusiasm. There was this strike it rich mentality as Bitcoin went through the roof. So it was sort of tailor-made for, you know, for scams. And of course, it also allowed for enormous anonymity. So it was sort of like a perfect storm of opportunity for people to do scams. At the same time, there was also a lot of sort of, I wouldn't call it scams, just innocent enthusiasm. You know, so a lot of people just put up coins that weren't going to work out. So a lot of people were going to lose money, not because they were trafficking with crooks, but just because these weren't, you know, very robust, you know, business schemes. So eventually the US regulators and regulators abroad started to wake up and pay more attention, you know, partially because I think they had a bit more confidence that they understood what these things really were. And then they started cracking down. We then sort of go into phase three, which is the blockchain enthusiasts not really knowing very much about regulations. So for example, they would start to go to the Cayman Islands and set up their coin system there, even though that's totally irrelevant for US securities laws, because if you're selling them into the US, the rules still apply. So you went through this sort of naive period where a lot of things were set up in ways that the people setting them up either thought or believed or hoped, you know, might be out beyond the reach of regulators, but they weren't. So as you look at it today, I think it's accurate to say that the US regulators, which I'm most familiar with, have still been pretty accommodating. You know, they're still trying, you know, to work with industry and say, you know, how can we make this work? But, you know, the adults are now in the room, and, you know, you can go to them, you can try and get something called a no action letter, where you can describe what you're trying to do, and the regulators will work with you and say, no, we won't allow that. But if you change it to this, then, you know, we say that at this point in time, we wouldn't take any action. So things are progressing, you know, and at the same time, a lot of the energy is out. You know, you don't see, you know, hundreds of new coins being launched every day. So things are stabilizing and still evolving. I remember that you're, you know, up on the, you know, the laws in Utah. You know, that might be worth you describing what's going on there right now.
I'm sorry, in Wyoming.
Wyoming. Beg pardon.
Yeah. Andy, you know, you gave us great insight on kind of how the federal regulators are kind of interacting with and trying to learn as much as they can with this new technology and entrepreneurs. There's one state in the United States that's kind of planted their flag, wanting to be kind of the crypto capital of the country, and that's Wyoming. They've done an excellent job, their state legislature, of setting up kind of a sandbox for these guys to kind of play in and negotiate around and try to bring their products to market. Do you have any clients who are looking at Wyoming, or are you familiar with what's going on in Wyoming?
No, I should mention that my work tends to be more representing the infrastructure behind blockchains. Most of them are maintained, or many of them are maintained by open source foundations. So my involvement is mostly in how the technology gets built and maintained, and less on the security side. Although I have represented companies. One went to, I think, Bolivia. So there's been a lot of experimentation along the way.
So if your clients had kind of a magic wand, what would be one thing that either state or federal regulators could do that could encourage further investment and expansion in this space?
Well, one of the things that is a little bit unusual in the way things have evolved to date is there's an effort to try and disassociate the coin from the company. And again, without sort of getting down in the weeds, there will be sort of the system that consumes the coin or uses the coin. And what they're trying to do is to basically beat the Howey test, about whether, you're an investor or not. So again, without getting too much down in the weeds, a lot of the structure goes into how can you issue a coin in some cases without being subject to the securities laws. So that's one particular area of endeavor that probably a lot of people, in the mackerel system, may run into, at least in the US, is are you going to be out and out a security, or will you be like most of the clients that are trying to say, how can I do this without being deemed to be a security and therefore not subject to the securities laws?
So does that, I could be wrong here, but does that kind of equate to I'm a utility token and not a securities?
Yeah. Right. Yep.
So this token's only here to function to operate within my ecosystem that we've set up, right? And it's not a speculative asset.
Right, exactly. And, the problem with that is that it can work rather well if that's really what you want to do. But if you wanted to make money out of selling the tokens, now you're trying to square the circle. So there's a lot of sort of trying to have it both ways. And the regulators are there to keep you from having it both ways.
Makes sense.
Yeah. And there are various ways to go about it. Again, kind of goes beyond the scope of, of today, but there are various, ways that if you have clients in this area, do a deeper dive into it. And there are models that are, evolving, and sort of guardrails that are growing up, at least, again, I'm most familiar with the US about how you can stay within that.
So let's talk a little bit about your books. Darlene mentioned early on that sometimes they're starting to have a common trend that actually end up happening here a couple years later. You wrote one on blockchain. Why don't you tell us the title of that and kind of some of the background on it?
Sure. Well, the backstory for the series is that I have a BA in history. I used a computer for a long time. I've probably written a grand total of, 50 lines of code in my whole life just to see a little bit how it works. But I've represented security clients and standards clients for most of my career. And yet I've now written 5 books based on 5 different technologies, where in each case I've shown how you could hack the SAC system, which is responsible for the nuclear weapons of the United States. I did a book on hacking presidential elections, if you can imagine that. I wrote that about 7 years ago. I could go on, but the concept is that each time I've written a book showing how you could hack vital systems, and then I've taken it to one of my clients that is a security expert and had them read it. And in each case, they've said, yeah, you could do that. This is not something which should make us feel good. So in each of these books, what I've done is I've taken a technology which the world has gone crazy over and which is believed to be secure, and then shown how, somebody who doesn't even have a technical background can find a hole in it that you could drive a truck through. So when blockchain first came up, I thought, well, it's obvious what my new book is about because of all the enthusiasm that was around this. And in particular, because of the sort of the hallmark that it's supposed to be secure. So it was a good, you know, challenge. And the concept that a lot of my books have an international scope and a political scope. So in this particular book, it revolves mostly around a cyber coin that the major banks of the world have decided that they're going to use, which is something that is happening. And another is a cyber coin that the Russians would be using, which of course is also something, you know, that's going to, is happening. So the book basically plays out against that stage and also shows how these systems that are being put into place really aren't necessarily as secure as everyone thinks or hopes that they should be.
So can you share with us maybe one of the most interesting things that you learned that you didn't expect to learn when you were researching on the book?
I think probably the thing you know, besides the little anecdotal things like dental tokens and that sort of thing, I think the thing that surprises me most is the degree of enthusiasm there is for the blockchain. In that there is sort of a sober side of established businesses that are sort of looking at this in a you know, just this is business. Is this a good solution? Is this not a good solution? But the degree of enthusiasm among the hacker community and the technical community is something that I really can't quite get to the bottom of. It's something that you're either a true believer or you don't get it. And, you know, even after all of my research, I still can't quite get why there is such a enthusiasm. There are elements, anonymity and independence of authority, you know, and I understand those could be, you know, very important, particularly if you're from a society where anonymity and can be important to your survival, and where independence of authority can be the only way that you can, you know, lead the kind of life we take for granted. But it sort of goes beyond that. It's sort of more of a, almost like a gamer level of enthusiasm.
Yeah, it's the crypto community, it's, I think, become very tribalized over the years, right? Everyone's got their favorite coin or handful of coins, and everything else is worthless. So it's kind of reflective of maybe some of our political environment today, too. Interesting to see that bleed over.
Of course, so where a do lot you of see... things surprise me less now than they did before the last election. So
yeah.
I don't think I know people as well as I used to.
Yeah, fair point. So kind of maybe in the next 5 or 10 years, I mean, where do you see this technology going, if anywhere? I mean, do you see, you know, publicly traded companies leveraging this, or do they kind of abandon it, or kind of full steam ahead?
Well, I think you're going to see, you know, maybe three different threads. One thread will be the boring thread, where people just say, hey, blockchain is a great way to keep track of information, you know, or transactions. And that I think you'll see lots and lots of private blockchains that are going to be out there all over society. And you probably don't even know that they're there, you know, because they won't necessarily be a competitive advantage. They won't be consumer facing. They'll just be, you know, the part of the engine that runs the machine. So I think that that will happen all over the place. And that, you know, that will just be part of the toolkit that people use to, you know, to run the world. The second one has to do with finance. And I think you probably will see an international coin-based system. Right now, of course, Facebook wants to launch Libra, which is moving forward, although without all the supporters that originally had. So there's one private sector system. It'll be interesting to see whether that works. I mean, they certainly have a big enough network, you know, billions of people. It's not a network that historically has been transactional, you know, so it isn't like, you know, PayPal or eBay or something like that. It's primarily been ad-based, not transactional-based. So, you know, that's sort of maybe not the best test, because it may be that the platform isn't really ideal for, you know, a global Coinbase system, but, you know, it'll be interesting to watch. Then you'll see the banks, which I think will have at some point, and they are working on it, a Coinbase system. There may be national systems. Venezuela talked about one, Russia talked about one, Iran talked about one. None of them has launched one yet that's been, you know, actually in practice. I don't know whether that'll happen. That's more of a political rather than an economic, you know, issue. I think you'll continue to have the Bitcoin world, but to me, it doesn't make a lot of sense for there to be thousands of coins. You know, it seems more likely that it would consolidate into a limited, you know, number of coins. So I think that blockchain is here to stay, but I think that it's going to be a whole lot more boring in the future.
Yeah, and it's really, you know, I think it's important for people to remember this is blockchain's kind of a beginning. It's not an end. It's really up to the companies and the people to figure out how to best leverage it for their unique circumstances.
Yeah, one use case I meant to mention and then didn't, the third one, is in the nonprofit world. There's some very interesting work being done. For example, the Gates Foundation has provided a lot of funding behind what's now a client of mine called Mojaloop. And the idea behind Mojaloop is that if you look at the emerging world, you have literally billions of people that don't have a bank account. They don't have a way to pay for anything other than, you know, cash. And that means also locally. And the concept of a blockchain where they could link into a Coinbase system and have the equivalent of a bank account at no cost and be able to transact across the world is something that was actually part of the very early vision. I mean, if you go back to, you know, 2009, I mean, some of the things that people talked about very shortly after Nakamoto introduced the white paper was one of the first, you know, use cases was bringing the financial world to the unbanked of the world. And here we are, you know, 11 years later, now that's actually happening with Mojaloop. Another client called Interledger is doing something similar. So the nonprofit world has you know, sort of jumped on the bandwagon. The problem with trying to launch something from the nonprofit world is taking something from where you've invested in the technology and created the proof of concept, but it's sort of the ultimate, if you build it, will they come? And, you know, it's easy for things to come out of the commercial world because, you know, some CEO has decided that they're going to, you know, put the corporate strategy behind it and the corporate dollars behind it. It's another thing for the nonprofit world to come up with something and say, we think this could have great utility, please make use of it. So the art on the side of the nonprofit will be, how will they try and migrate it, you know, out of the lab and into, you know, actual use. But, you know, signs are hopeful. Mojaloop, for example, is doing quite well.
Yeah, and you bring up a great point. I've spent some time in Kenya and over there, one, nobody has a landline. Everyone has a cell phone. And then, but that cell phone's their number one way that they transact. They pay their bills, they send their friends money all through their cell phone. So it's kind of an interesting comparison, right? Here in America, you know, my generation, we didn't grow up. I didn't grow up with a landline, right? Everyone grew up with a cell phone. So this idea that some countries are jumping, making an evolutional jump, right? It's going from no bank account to being their own bank and being able to control their own money. So that's a very interesting point you make. And people don't realize, I mean, we pretty much are a cashless society today here in America, right? Cash is still accepted, but, you know, the vast majority of transactions are through the internet, right? Using a credit card. And you brought up a point earlier, you know, maybe there might be a time in the future when people are interacting with the blockchain and they don't even know it. You don't necessarily have to understand the technology to either benefit from it or use it, right? Just kind of like our cell phones today.
Yeah, almost the definition of a mature technology is one that you've forgotten even exists.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Yeah. Andy, is there anything else that you want to try to hit on that we haven't yet?
I don't think so. I think that the, you know, maybe the thought to leave people with as lawyers is that, you know, unlike a lot of what we do as lawyers, where we're used to, you know, dealing with businesses where everything is, you know, non-passionate in the case of blockchain, there's still a lot of passion. So unless you're a lawyer that works with startups, you know, this may be something that's a little bit novel to you in that there's a level of familiarity and a level of jargon and a level of backstory and a level of sort of inside baseball that, you know, people will talk about that you may have to spend some extra time just sort of, you know, reading up about it generally somewhere other than a book of statutes.
That's great advice, Andy. Really appreciate that. And I think you're spot on. It's the level of enthusiasm is pretty much unparalleled in any industry. And as you mentioned before, it's you either get it or you don't, you're either all in or you're not. And I'm sure in your conversations with clients, there's way more questions than there are kind of black and white answers. And you have to have, I'm sure your clients have to have a level of risk appetite that meets those needs.
Right. Great way to find out about blockchain, by the way, is reading The Blockchain Revolution, available at Amazon and everywhere else too.